Today we're going to be looking at states of matter in the kitchen. Now, everything you can see, taste, touch, and smell in this kitchen is made of something called matter. Now, all matter is made up of very small particles and usually comes in three main forms or states. These are known as solids, liquids, and gases. The three common states of matter, solids, liquids, and gases, have different observable properties and behave in different ways. A solid has a fixed volume and a fixed shape. Solids are usually tough and rigid. Their particles are close together and vibrate while in a fixed position. Solids cannot be easily compressed. A liquid has a fixed volume, but does not have a fixed shape, as liquids will take on the shape of the container they are in. The energy levels of particles in liquids is greater than solids. The particles move freely enough to collide and move past each other, and liquids cannot be easily compressed. A gas has no fixed volume or shape. A gas takes on both the shape and the volume of the container, spreading out to fill the entire space. The particles have lots of energy and move randomly in all directions, and gases can be compressed. Did you know we can change the state of matter by either heating or cooling it? The kitchen is a great place to demonstrate these transformations, also known as changes of state. There are four main changes of state matter can go through. Freezing is when a liquid changes state into a solid, while melting is when a solid changes state back into a liquid. Vaporization is when a liquid changes state into a gas, while condensation is when a gas changes state back into a liquid. A great way to show matter going through each change of state is to use water. You see, water is a unique substance because the properties of water allow it to actually exist in all three states. And I can show you all four changes of state right here in the kitchen. So the first change of state I'm going to show you is from a liquid to a solid. Okay, this water is definitely still in its liquid state, but let's put it in the freezer and see what happens. By placing the water, the liquid, into the freezer and dropping it to a temperature below 0 degrees Celsius, we were able to change the state of water from a liquid to a solid. And this solid is known as ice, and the whole process is known as freezing. So the next change of state I'm going to demonstrate is turning a solid piece of ice into liquid, but it requires some heat. By applying the heat to the solid state of water, known as ice, we were able to change its state into a liquid, and this whole process is known as melting. The next change of state we're going to look at is the change from a liquid into a gas.
There are two ways water can change state from a liquid into a gas, and these are known as evaporation and boiling. And both are examples of the phase change vaporization. Boiling is when water is heated and bubbles form within the liquid and rise to the surface. The temperature at which water boils is around 100 degrees Celsius. This is known as its boiling point.
You can actually see this change of state happening right before your eyes. The liquid or water is turning into steam.
Steam is very hot and actually invisible. The misty cloud above the boiling pot we can see is in fact known as wet steam, which is a mixture of steam, the gas, and tiny water droplets. Evaporation occurs at temperatures below 100 degrees Celsius and typically takes place on the surface of the liquid, where the liquid will slowly change state into an invisible gas or water vapor. Evaporation occurs at a much slower rate than boiling.
The final change of state we're going to look at today is condensation, and that's changing from a gas back into a liquid. When the cold surface of the lid comes in contact with this hot gas or steam, it will actually change state back into a liquid. Now we understand how heating and cooling affects the state of matter, we can use this knowledge to our advantage when we perform everyday tasks like cooking food. And I'm going to do just that today. I'm going to cook up these veggies and chicken by changing the state of water from a liquid to a gas. So this cooking method we're using today is known as steaming. And you can see why. It primarily uses steam to cook the food. And I'd say this chicken is almost done. Now, who would have thought there was so much science right here in the kitchen? And today, we were able to steam this small piece of chicken and veggies in a short amount of time. But what if we were trying to cook for, say, a large group of people? Well, people have been utilizing steam as a means of cooking food for thousands of years, and not just in kitchens. Today, I'm going to show you a cooking technique that is thousands of years old, and it's still used today. And it also uses heat to change the state of water, a liquid, into a gas. But this time, it's not done on the stovetop, it's done underground.
Cooking underground using steam is what is called an underground or earth oven. Ground ovens are used by Aboriginal and Torres Strait Islander people Australia-wide.
Ground ovens were used to cook a variety of food items, everything from fish, stingray, turtle, dugong, and even vegetables. And they're also a great way to cook for large groups of people. But today I'll be cooking and steaming these sweet potato and this fish I caught earlier today.
A ground oven is prepared by digging out a hole around 100 centimetres long and around 60 centimetres deep. A fire is built beside the hole with dry rocks placed in the fire to heat them up. Next, the fish and sweet potato are prepared. The fish is wrapped in fresh native ginger leaves and placed inside wet paper bark and secured with twine. The hole is then filled with hot coals and heated rocks from the fire. The prepared food is placed on a layer of green leaves or branches and sprinkled with water. The hole is then covered with a thick layer of paper bark that acts as a seal or lid to the oven. The hole is quickly covered with sand to prevent loss of steam and heat. The food is then left to cook for several hours. The ground oven is a brilliant way to cook large quantities of food, and it's a cooking method that has stood the test of time.
This cooking method looks like a lot of effort, but it actually has its advantages. There's not a great deal of attention required when cooking the food, but also all the heating and steaming and cooking is done underground. Let's take a closer look.
The secret to a ground oven's success is in its ability to conserve the heat generated by the rocks, while the earth and paper bark lid prevent heat loss to the outside environment. Let's go in for a closer look. The hot rocks and embers heat up the air at the base of the oven, making it less dense or lighter. This now hot air rises away from the base to the top of the oven. As the hot air rises, it pulls the cooler air from the top of the oven down to the bottom to replace it. This will continue until the heat is evenly distributed throughout the oven. As almost all foods contain water, as the temperature rises within the oven, the heated liquid water present in the food reaches boiling point at around 100 degrees Celsius and changes state from a liquid into a gas to produce steam. The wrapping of the green ginger leaves and wet paper bark provide additional moisture and insulation around the food. The thick waterproof paper bark traps the heat and steam within the food parcel, preventing it from escaping. After several hours, the food will be cooked and the hot rocks will have lost their heat, dropping the overall temperature within the oven. The cooling process forces the remaining steam inside the paper bark parcels to change state again, from a gas, the steam, back into liquid water by means of condensation. This is why much of the original moisture in the food is retained.
The intricate knowledge around food preparation and design has allowed Aboriginal and Torres Strait Islander people to use the properties of water to improve essential daily activities like cooking and eating.
Today we have learned how heating and cooling of matter can create a change in its state. These phase changes are happening all around us every day, from freezing to steaming. The knowledge and processes of changing states between matter plays an important role in all cooking processes we see today, and it has influenced both modern and traditional cooking techniques around the world.